So we are very happy to report that, in fact, what happened at Union Station, there you see a picture of the fountain in front of Union Station. You can't see any signs of smoke. May simply have been unrelated. We've heard reports of a truck fire and other things as well.
All right, we go now to my colleague Shepard Smith, back once again on the roof of the Fox News Channel headquarters. Shepard?
Linda, we've been watching over the building down lower Manhattan, probably 70, 80 blocks down there, and certainly those rescue efforts, which Catherine Herridge was describing, are underway. I understand they're moving some of the perimeters, and our senior correspondent, Eric Shawn, is there. Eric, are they kicking you out of there?
Removed to an area a little further north. Basically, one situation is that the wind has changed. All day since we've been here since 3 in the morning, the wind had been heading south, taking that plume south and over the Hudson River. Now it has turned around and it is, excuse me, it's been coming up north. So making it a little difficult, plus communications here are difficult with our cell phone service. You talk about the lack of victims, sadly, in the sense that more people would not be able to be treated at the hospital, indicating they could be dead. You wouldn't think that anyone could survive this two 110-story buildings and the 48, number 7 World Trade Center, but in fact, at least 9 people have survived. They were miraculously plucked from in that debris. 4 New York City firefighters, 3 cops, 1 man, one of those police officers, Port Authority officer John McGlaughlin, the miracle man of this day here. He, according to the rescuers, rode that building down from the 82nd floor. When he was rescued and pulled out from underneath the debris, he said he was on the 82nd floor when that building imploded, and he rode that building all the way down to what is left of the World Trade Center, just a 5-story hunk of twisted metal and concrete and burnt out crushed cars here in the street of New York. We're now with Peter Kirkland, who's helped work with the removal of some of the material. Is it orderly? What are they looking for? Is it focused?
We came to work this morning and we decided what are we going to do today? We're an independent metal shop. And we said, well, why don't we give it a chance and try to go to the Williamsburg Bridge and see if we can go and volunteer. We had no preconceived ideas of what we were going to do when we arrived.
What did you do when you were here?
We were most effective untangling the oxygen and acetylene hoses. That seemed like there were a lot of iron workers, very focused, doing their job. And my team, four co-workers, found that we were most effective untangling the oxygen acetylene hose.
So you're talking about people doing very specialized jobs.
Yes.
From pulling people out, and iron workers taking care of the iron, maybe other people.
Yes.
Breaking apart.
Yeah.
Concrete.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then moving the cranes.
There was crane people and the fire department. I was really impressed with the fire department, and they're all working in unison because they're moving from small pieces, moving up to larger pieces, and then there was a 100-foot crane that was their last objective. We found that we needed to leave because they were at a point where it was getting kind of dangerous, where they were getting to some of the larger structural pieces that I felt we would kind of be in their way.
Well, Peter, that is one element that, because they worked all night, took out about 120 trailer trucks worth of debris going on barges, leaving the area, and they have a lot more to go. They are now moving toward the larger sections, the big cranes, heavy equipment moving in here to try and move some of these big sections to hopefully get to some of the people who they believe are trapped in pockets called voids underneath the World Trade Center, specifically some of the areas of the shopping arcade and perhaps even the basement. People who were in the basement who were able to survive and are basically still alive, who have been in contact with authorities and family members through the cell phone.
Yeah.
And have been able to withstand this thing because of the superstructure of the World Trade Center still enabling them to survive. So for right now, that's where the situation here stands. 2,000 emergency workers busy at work in high gear, hoping that they can get more people, more than just the 9 that have already been saved. We're live in Lower Manhattan at the site. Eric Shawn, Fox News. Back
Eric,
to you.
Thanks. Let's hope and pray. He was mentioning this plume of smoke over the past 24 hours. It has drifted east over toward Brooklyn and left a lot of ash there and left toward North Jersey. But the smoke has never come north toward the rest of Manhattan. So above 14th Street into Midtown, the Upper East and West sides of town, you never even smelled the smoke, never saw it. The soot never came here. But now the wind has certainly shifted. and this reality of South Manhattan or Lower Manhattan is making its way to the rest of New York City. It's hard to miss. Linda Vester, back down to you.
All right, Shepard, thank you very much. A little more information coming in as we take you back to Boston, which seems to be the hub of activity in the FBI investigation. You're looking at the Westin Hotel in Boston. This is where police and FBI swarmed in a little bit earlier today with shields and battering rams going into, it appears, at least one room that is believed to have belonged to one of the suspects, one of the hijackers. Let's listen to WBZ local coverage.
Yesterday, but this scene does look like it at least starting to slow down. Still a crime scene, but I think what may come out of here, we understand that one person was brought into custody and that they executed a search warrant on the 13th and quite possibly the 16th floors of this hotel. What they got out of there may help them in this investigation.
Okay, we are going to continue keeping an eye on Boston because we mentioned a little bit earlier, we've gotten word that apparently law enforcement is also waiting to execute a search warrant in a suburb of Boston. It's called Newton. It's not very far from downtown Boston. There is a hotel called the Park Inn at Chestnut Hill. Apparently, FBI and local police are there on the scene. They have a search warrant. They're waiting to execute it. We're going to keep you updated on that. In the meantime, we take it now to the White House. Correspondent James Rosen is there on the North Lawn. James.
Well, Linda, a well-informed source close to the Bush administration tells Fox News that authorities have already identified by name the hijackers of at least United Airlines flight number 93. This was the flight that left Newark, New Jersey, bound for Los Angeles, and of course met its tragic end in Pennsylvania. According to this source, the key to solving the entire investigation is, and I quote, what we're finding in Pennsylvania at the wreck site, located 80 miles southeast of Pittsburgh. Quote, there is much there that didn't burn and has been salvaged, the source said. And based on materials already found in Shanksville, Pennsylvania, the source says, and I quote, the hijackers have been identified by name, unquote. Now, the source also specified that these individuals, these named individuals, are indeed linked to Osama bin Laden, the Islamic militant who has served on the FBI's 10 most wanted list and who has been linked to various terror attacks against Americans over the past decade. Meantime, President Bush convened a meeting of his national security team this morning and made brief remarks beforehand. Mr. Bush saying yesterday's attacks were more than acts of terror, but acts of war. But the president reminded Americans that we face what he called a different enemy than we have faced before.
This enemy hides in shadows and has no regard for human life. This is an enemy who preys on innocent and unsuspecting people, then runs for cover. But it won't be able to run for cover forever. This is an enemy that tries to hide, but it won't be able to hide forever. This is an enemy that thinks its harbors are safe, but they won't be safe forever.
Now, President Bush this morning met with a bipartisan, bicameral group of congressional leaders. What that means, if you don't speak Washingtonese, is that the leaders came from both the House and the Senate and from both the Democratic Party and the Republican Party. A key agenda item in that meeting was an emergency supplemental funding request. Capitol Hill sources say this will amount to a blank check to be used to help with the search and rescue operations and also to help rebuild Lower Manhattan and the damaged section of the Pentagon. After this meeting, those leaders approached microphones outside the White House and said they stand figuratively and literally shoulder to shoulder with the president, ready to help him do whatever he decides to do to retaliate for these attacks. But to recap, authorities have identified by name the hijackers of at least United Airlines Flight 93, the Newark to Los Angeles flight that crashed in Pennsylvania. This according to a source well-informed and close to the Bush administration. We take it back to our colleagues in New York.
James Rosen on the North Lawn of the White House. James, thanks very much for that. Also, a little piece of information coming in about the airlines and how they are responding to the grieving families of those who are on board those four hijacked doomed flights. American Airlines has now joined United Airlines in offering $25,000 to each family of each victim on board those planes, this to help them meet immediate needs. American Airlines going also a little bit further, asking its employees not to react with anger toward Arab Americans and have a knee-jerk response. Perhaps a difficult order to carry out, but American Airlines asking its staffers not to react with anger specifically toward American Airlines, even though it does appear now that there may be a link here to Osama bin Laden.
There is also, of course, curiosity about what the after effects might be in a legal sense from what happened yesterday, whether or not there are going to be lawsuits that ensue, not only against the airlines, but whether against the authorities involved in the World Trade Center, which used to be a part of Port Authority. Now it's privately owned, and there are questions about exactly who might be sued by whom and how much. A lot of economic repercussions, of course, this happening in an economic downturn, if not a recession, or if not in the beginning of a recession. The question is, how will the markets react? Of course, Lower Manhattan is trying to dig out from underneath all the rubble, and that means that the exchanges have been closed. There are some inklings that perhaps before the end of the week they will be reopened. What happens when they do reopen? A huge question in an economic downturn. Already our own Neil Cavuto is reporting that some people he's been contacting are pulling their money out any way they can. Of course, it's difficult to find a play to do that in an environment in which only European and foreign Asian markets are open, but they are trying to do that.
David, as you well know, overnight the Nikkei was down to a level unprecedented or unseen, at least in 17 years. So much of the money going into gold and going into oil, which is a, you know, a classic place that people, when they can't figure out where to put their money, end up putting it. There are fears about the markets here, but Neil seems confident that we'll be able to rebound from this. Midway Airlines, one which will not rebound, citing concerns regarding yesterday's attack. Midway Airlines has shut down all operations, will not reopen. 1,700 employees without jobs now, and the hope is that that is not just the tip of the iceberg. It is going to be a daunting challenge for President George W. Bush, not only to manage the emotions of the nation as the leader of us all, but also to handle whatever repercussions are necessary. It's worthwhile to look at history to learn a little bit about what our future may bring us. Hugh Seide is a presidential historian and friend of the channel who's joined us often. Hugh, good to see you. Hugh, are you with us?
Yes, I'm here. Yes, I'm there, or I think I'm there.
The president, with so much on his plate this day and so much to do in the days to come, to what president's activities might he look for some degree of guidance? What's worked and what hasn't?
Well, I think you can go all the way back. Of course, we've had Pearl Harbor mentioned, the assassination of John Kennedy, the responses of Lyndon Johnson. I think you go to Ronald Reagan and his responses to terrorism.
Excuse me for the interruption. We have breaking news in Washington, straight to Brit Hume now. Brit?
Shep, it's worth noting what's happening on the Senate floor right now. The majority leader, Senator Daschle, asked that all members take their seats for a roll call vote on the resolution. It is a sense of the Congress resolution that will clear both houses, supporting the president and condemning what has happened. It speaks before the resolution is over of support for what is called a war to eradicate terrorism. There had been some debate about whether the word war would be used, but on a bipartisan basis, we understood that there was willingness to do that. This is likely to pass unanimously. It is unusual to see all members sitting in their seats voting. And let's listen to a little of it.
Mr. Corzine, aye. Mr. Craig. Mr. Craig, aye. Mr. Crapo. Mr. Crapo, aye. Mr. Daschle. Mr. Daschle, aye.
Well, there you heard the vote by the majority leader himself. The voice you hear is that of the clerk, whose job it is to call the roll. And on a vote of this kind, what you're seeing is the customary repetition after each member casts his or her vote. Of the nature of that vote for the benefit of people like ourselves who are listening or who may be watching from the gallery. So this is the first legislative response that we've had to this. This is a resolution that was which was devised in the House and the Senate. This is not something that the president had asked for, obviously, although it expresses support for him. It is, as I said, a sense of the Congress, in this case, a sense of the Senate resolution. It will also pass the House, has also passed the House, that is support for him and the other things that you would expect. It is not possible to gauge from this, Shep, what else Congress might be willing to do, but the sense one has in this town at this point is that whatever additional efforts the president may wish to make, military, relief, rescue, rebuilding, he is very likely to get, and that the money, the $160 billion of surplus Social Security revenues, which for perhaps one of the first times in American history was declared off limits for general spending will now be on limits.
Britt, you mentioned this word war. I wonder about the significance of that and would be interested to hear your take on it, given that we have a war on drugs that many might argue we don't really seem to be in the business of wanting to win.
Well, in this context, of course, this is a sense of the Congress resolution. It is non-binding. It has none of the effect that a declaration of war would have. The president has not asked for a declaration of war. If he were to do so, of course, at this point, it is unclear against whom and what the declaration would be declared, so it would be made.